Political Parties and the RTI Act. The issue of political parties coming under the ambit of the Right to Information Act was in the news again after the Supreme Court issued notices to the six national parties to explain their stand. The issue dates back to 2013 when the Central Information Commission made a historic order bringing the six national parties under the RTI Act. The present BJP government, in its counter affidavit in the Supreme Court, said that the political parties cannot be brought under the RTI Act. The Association for Democratic Reforms, that is the ADR, had filed a writ petition in the Supreme Court against the Government of India and the six national parties that failed to comply with the Central Information Commission order, bringing these parties under the ambit of the Right to Information Act. The Supreme Court had admitted this petition and issued notices to the six national parties as well as the Government of India. Now the Government of India filed a counter affidavit in the Supreme Court saying that the political parties cannot be brought under the RTI Act, thus towing the line taken by the previous UPA government. The Central Information Commission Order of 2015. The full bench of the Central Information Commission, that is the CIC, in its historic order in June of 2013, ruled that the six national parties, that is INC, that is the Indian National Congress, BJP, CPI, CPM, BSP and the NCP are public authorities under Section 2H of the RTI Act and that they are supposed to comply with the provisions of the Act. The order cited the following reasons in detail for categorizing the political parties as public authorities: direct and indirect benefits by the government like subsidized land for party offices, income tax exemptions, free airtime on Doordarshan and All India Radio, supplying electoral roll copies free of cost during elections, etc. Political parties perform a public function and constitutional and statutory status of political parties. The political parties on their part said that none of the benefits can be construed as substantial financing as such practices exist in most democracies, but the CIC did not agree with them. So what happened after that? The six national parties did not comply with the decision of the CIC by not appointing a public information officer. In the meanwhile, the political parties unanimously decided to introduce a bill in the Lok Sabha towards the end of 2013 to amend the RTI Act. This amendment would effectively nullify the CIC order and exempt the political parties from the RTI. This amendment was also supposed to be retrospective in nature. After a public outcry, the bill was referred to a department-related standing committee. The bill could not be passed before the expiry of the 15th Lok Sabha and hence got lapsed. In the meanwhile, the original petitioners moved the CIC again against the non-compliance of its orders by the political parties. The CIC conducted two hearings on the matter in November 2014 and again in January of 2015. The political parties decided not to send any representative to these hearings. After the hearings, the CIC, in a fresh order in March of 2015, reiterated its earlier ruling and effectively said that it cannot do more than issuing an order and it is not in a position to get its own order implemented. Following this, the petitioners have approached the Supreme Court. So what does the government say now? The Government of India, in its counter affidavit in the Supreme Court, said that the CIC has made a very liberal interpretation of Section 2H of the RTI Act and that it led to an erroneous conclusion that political parties are public authorities under the RTI Act. The present government has taken the following grounds against the CIC order. It also says that political parties were never visualized to be within the ambit of the RTI Act. It says that the political parties under the ambit of the RTI Act would hamper the smooth internal working of the parties. The political rivals with malicious intentions would file RTI applications, thereby adversely affecting the functioning of the parties. There are already provisions in the Representations of People Act of 1951 as well as the Income Tax Act of 1961 that lead to transparency regarding the financial aspects of the political parties. So in conclusion, what does all this mean? We will have to wait and see how the Supreme Court's response is. But one thing is clear, that all the political parties are united sans ideology when it comes to parties being brought under the ambit of the RTI Act. While there might be genuine concerns about the potential misuse by political opponents, neither the government nor the political parties have come forward with any plan to implement the recommendations of the law of the various law commission reports regarding financial transparency of the political parties.